Welcome, friends. Today, we are going to have somebody as a visitor, as an expert, to discuss with us. And in our series of having experts on the subject, industrial relations, we have today with us Dr. Shashikala Gurpur, principal of Symbiosis Law College, Pune, as well as Dean, Symbiosis University Law Faculty. Before I proceed, friends, it would be in the fitness of things that I introduce Madam Dr. Shashikala Gurpur to you. We are very fortunate. And moreover, friends, what makes me call her as an invitee, as she's an expert on the subject. Many a times we see many things are spoken of that academics should have something to do with the industry, and the industry has huge expectations from academics. What is this total theory? What is this total phenomena about? What is academics? Are they foreign? Are they intrinsically mixed? Is there some rationale between, or what is wrong in the expectation, or is the expectation right? Are so many questions which are to be answered. And friends, on behalf of all of you, I'm going to ask her questions. But before I proceed, let me introduce you to you, our expert on the subject today, Dr. Shashikala Gurpur. Yes, friends, I'll just read out her bio data. Allow me to read it. Okay. Dr. Shashikala Gurpur is an accomplished academician, passionate researcher, toastmaster, and a Fulbright scholar. She holds a Ph.D. in international law from the University of Mysore, Karnataka State Government Award, gold medal for topping in LL.M, and was AHRB Visiting Fellow, Edinburgh Law School, UK. She was selected for the Fulbright-Nehru Administrators Seminar in 2011. She has an impressive career with a wide range of impactful experience in teaching, research, NGOs, and industry. She is continuing with Symbiosis Law School since 2007 and is a pioneer in EU legal studies in India. She has presented more than 339 invited lectures. Friends, we are really fortunate to have her today with us, but let me continue. She's participated in so many workshops and seminars in prestigious universities, conferences, and forums across the globe. She has more than 32 years of work experience in academia and corporate combined. Her teaching experience includes tenures in National Law School of India University, Bengaluru, Manipal Institute of Communication, and University College Cork, Ireland. Her teaching and research interests encompass jurisprudence, media law, international law, human rights, research methodology, feminine legal studies, biotechnology law, and social transformation laws, besides having guided more than 100 masters and 12 PhD students. I mean, they have worked under her, and she is currently guiding 8 doctoral research students. Dr. Gurpur has 79 research papers, 2 co-authored books, and 15 book chapters to her credit, and 4 magazine articles. She has presented more than 339 invited lectures and workshops and seminars across India, Thailand, US, UK, Ireland, Germany, Australia, Canada, and UAE. It's almost more than 3/4 of the globe, friends. Dr. Shashikala Gurpur is the recipient of several distinct honors, awards, and recognition for her contribution in a legal education, gender sensitization, and community outreach programs. In recognition of her contribution to the Indian legal academia, she was listed in the book 100 Legal Luminaries of India by LexisNexis. Dr. Gurpur has recently been conferred with the prestigious annual Kittur Rani Chennamma Award by the Government of Karnataka, India in 2018 for her work towards empowerment of women. Dr. Gurpur was a member of the Law Commission of India, Ministry of Law and Justice, Government of India, and is currently a member on Curricular Development Committee, Life Member, Indian Law Institute, member CDC, former member Bar Council of India, and a distinguished member of the editorial board of the Cyber Law University International e-Journal. She has been awarded the honorary membership of Association of Young International Criminal Lawyers. She is also having an annual membership of the member of Asian Law Institute, Faculty of Law, Singapore. And friends, Dr. Shashikala Gurpur, alongside leadership at Symbiosis Law College, contributed to the law faculty under the Symbiosis International Deemed University, especially for the law schools under its banner in Noida, Hyderabad, and Nagpur. She has been instrumental in international research projects like Eurasia, 21st Teach Skill Project, ILFM, DAAD, and Erasmus Grants membership with international bodies such as International Association of Law Schools, Asian Law Institute, IUCN, etc. Friends, it's only for the want of time I'm stopping, but then there is much more to her credit, much more to be spoken of. And friends, the only thing is that we are very fortunate enough to have a discussion with an expert like Dr. Shashikala Gurpur.
Thank you, Dr. Srikant Malagaonkar. It is my pleasure to be interviewed by you, an eminent jurist as well as a great lawyer and a scholar. Simzu channel is going to be a great opportunity for me to demonstrate as well as to be examined for my relevance to the greatest impacting force of this country, namely the industry and business.
Welcome, madam. Friends, let's begin with our interview. And on behalf of all of you, I'm going to ask madam questions. Here comes question number one. Madam, we are all aware that for the past 2 years, we had the COVID pandemic going on almost in 3/4 of the world. Many countries were affected, many people lost jobs. And this period has been a very scary and a very trying period. And Indian industry was also affected. So my question to you is, how do you see the industrial relations after COVID, or the impact of COVID on Indian industrial relations? Yes, madam.
So COVID impact on industrial scenario, all of us are aware of, or we can recall the grim scenario of 2020 of the mass exodus of migrant workers, which showed that industrial relations never made any kind of special arrangements for containing the maximum labor who were migrants. Now, in the post-COVID scenario, what we are seeing is that these migrant labor, after the first lockdown, they came back. Between the first and the second wave, a number of them returned, and a lot of money was spent by employers to bring them back as well, sometimes luring them into better payment also. Now, as such, this shows the apathy of our industrial employers in looking at this big number, which may not be mattering in the hierarchy of the industry. Second is that at the national level also, security measures, assurances, some of the migrant labor to whom we spoke, they said that we do not know what kind of safety is there, who will look after us. If we die, let us go and die in our hometown. So that reveals that there's an awful lot of reform required in labor law. There's an awful lot of consideration to be given to this lowest rung of the industrial workforce in terms of their health, in terms of their security, in terms of their accommodation, most of all, and also in terms of their family environment. Now, I saw that between the first and second wave, through the District Legal Aid Service Authority, we conducted a kind of little campaign for providing this labor card to the labor who were migrating to Pune. We were trying to gather the legal aid for them in terms of such safety precautions. Thousands of them come and land in some place, and then they are escorted by the agents to these respective production centers. And there is no standardization of their wages. There is no standardization of these commissions they give to these. And this is all happening under the very nose of the state. So in the post-COVID scenario, this is at the labor level. But if you look at the higher level in terms of officials and others, we have seen that there was a mass layoff in some industries. These made a big news. They went viral. There was also the issue of lack of second line leadership, sufficient advanced thinking in terms of creating wherewithal, skilling and health measures. In some of the organizations, on some level of employees, even the vaccination had to be paid for. So this shows that our country, in terms of industrial relations, is least prepared for any crisis such as this pandemic. And we need to have better social security and health security approaches, including mass coverage of health insurance, group insurance. I also have come to know that in many companies, the kind of private insurance that they had subscribed to, they were thinking that it is a charity gesture, but the percentage of claims being realized also was much lower in private insurance. So these are some of the issues which need or warrant legal reforms in this area.
Very well said, madam. Yes, what you said is gives us food to ponder upon. And this brings me to the next question. The next question, madam, now we are discussing academics and industry. You are an academician of great acclaim. I just now read out your bio data. I mean, there are no words to express my feelings over that. And my question to you, madam, is how do you think academics can contribute and keep pace with the changing industrial relations in India? Yes, madam.
As an academic who has had a 3-year stint in the HR department of a multinational health conglomerate in the Middle East, and also being a passionate feminist and activist, I have come across situations where our intervention made a difference to the penury and the pain of the labor. I've also seen serving on the boards of a couple of, if not manufacturing, a service sector organizations, that there are many human resource management best practices which could be cascaded to many of Indian organizations. Now, being a law person, I've also seen that one of the important verticals of human resource management in the industry, which is training and development, their academics could play a huge role. Other than this, academics could be conducting number of empirical studies. Now, one of the issues, for example, is the relationship between employment and unemployment and industrial relation. This example could be better studied in an empirical context rather than in just secondary literature or secondary resource learning context. Now, for this empirical study, academics who are very well trained in empirical research methodologies are required. Aside from that, for academic life as such, in terms of engaging with students, let us say, first of all, in developing a very relevant curriculum or in skilling the students by taking them to these industrial visits or interacting with the officers who are dealing with day-to-day on legal issues or advocates like yourself who will teach up-to-date skills like domestic inquiry or the latest legislation, the Prevention of Sexual Harassment at Workplace Act. All these could be better learnt and better taught, and a few skills could be mastered by teachers like us by keeping a very close relationship with the industry, among many other things. Other than this, the important academic wing of academic life, namely the students, could be exposed to internships. They could be exposed to internship in the industry. They could be exposed to shadow working as executive assistants to the CEOs, among many other things, than in addition to interning with the labor lawyers and others. So this is how I broadly see the nexus between academics and industry.
Very correctly put it, madam. Thank you. And I mean, this as the we progress with the interview, there are so many questions which have clouded my mind, but for the sake of all our viewers, we are having law students, we are having budding HR managers, budding administrators, budding directors. And for all of them, I mean, how do you see your careers in industry for law students and HR managers? I mean, how do you see what could be their future? How can they shape their destiny? Yes, madam.
Now, first of all, the career and placement cell, as it is called, which is not a necessary wing of a law school, but it's a very important wing of management school. So when you are asking this question, I'm keeping a transdisciplinary kind of scenario in front of me, whether it is students of communication who have a relevance in corporate communication to manage the public relation, to manage the media when there is a crisis, to manage public opinion towards the industry, because industry is very, very dependent on social interaction. Second is about environmental concerns. So here our environmental scientists and environmental lawyers and environmental policymakers have a great role to play. Other than that, the law graduates, when we train them, we are looking at plenty of opportunities within the industry. So we have to train them being ready for diverse careers. And some of the diverse careers emanate from the non-legal space of industry as well as legal space of industry. Now, in legal space, we can have different hierarchies, starting from legal assistant to legal associate to the law officer and a general legal manager in big companies, you know, which have 60,000 crore turnover per year, ranging to 1,000 crore turnover per year, or even MSME. Will definitely require a law person at two levels. One is in general compliance area, because industries will have to, I'm sure, comply with not less than 100 legislations, and year on year they have to be up to date. And secondly, they could work very well within the HR vertical as well. This HR vertical is the one which recruits human resource. So at that time, recruiting legal experts could be guided by a law graduate. Other than that, we also have exclusively the wings of labor law, human welfare, human resources, where or even the pay scale, the latest policies, the latest circulars, regulations. This is where a law graduate can assist. Even as a general manager or general legal manager or as a management trainee, a law graduate can make a significant difference. If you look at the leadership role of the industry, we always see marketing people occupying the CEO's role or finance people occupying the CEO's role. Lately, it has been changing. I'm seeing many law graduates coming to occupy that role after a good stint in HR or in the labor department or in the legal department. This is going to be important for future, because what we see in management is managing the situation with little consideration for ethics. So it's a short-term, immediate kind of response. Whereas when a law graduate manages a leadership role, law graduate looks at what Jim Collins calls built to last. So law graduates or law experts' key role as a CEO will make a long-term impact and on the industry and its survival and better performance, and also on the society and the nation in terms of better ethical compliance and far-sighted problem-solving approaches.
Yeah, thank you, madam. And all of the law students and HR managers who are young of age today have great careers in the Indian industry. But then again, this brings me, always industry expects something from academicians. So in your opinion, what are the expectations of the Indian industry from academics? Or how can academics contribute to the Indian industry? Yes, madam.
I always saw that. I remember one journalist, very senior journalist, telling when I was in college days, Mr. Patil Puttappa, celebrated journalist, that advanced countries have expertise being heard by the powerful, and India has powerful being heard by the experts. So expertise is in the academia. There's so much of expertise which is locked up in our leading institutions in the form of these academics who are exposed worldwide, who are churning out very good research, which could be comparable to sometimes world-class research, although the percentage is small. Now, if expertise is guiding the industry or business, it's going to make a huge difference in terms of risk prevention, in terms of loss prevention, in terms of bringing the realities which are otherwise ignored by doing actual field-based studies. That's why, as I already told, If you look at the transition of American businesses or European businesses, we see that once the resurgence after the Second World War happened, academics played a very key role and they were taken seriously by management people. Now, so academia can play a role in being advisory, rendering expertise, generating research reports. For example, now with the export promotion zones, we have a lot of experts writing on that. In the COVID-19 scenario, Shamsundar, this labor economist, has written extensively in terms of the lethal effects of COVID-19 and the unpreparedness of Indian industry. So academics can always change waves and ready the industry for crisis with the fact-based, impartial, neutral opinion, which is always to the advantage. I was always told of how J.R.D. Tata, traveling with Swami Vivekananda, was advised by Swami Vivekananda not to travel to US but to create a steel industry in India, and it changed the destiny of India. He gave another advice that you open a world-class science center in India, and he went and opened the Tata Institute of Fundamental Sciences, which became the best research institute in the country, namely the Indian Institute of Science. So the visionaries, in terms of people who think differently, who think for all the mankind or humankind and the nation, have always the right kind of advice to offer. So it's it is the advantage to the industry.
Well, madam, this brings us to the next question now. Over the years, many things have been spoken as regards the Indian industry and what would be the future. And this brings in the arena of three basic rights. That is, one is right to disconnect. We really want to understand it from you as to what is this right to disconnect itself. And on all of yours, would also like to ask you one thing. I'm just asking you on behalf of them. What is work-related stress? What is work-related toxicity? Every Indian as office atmosphere is, I should say, it's been cursed with these two words, work stress and workplace toxicity. So what would be your comments on that, madam? Yes, ma'am.
This whole idea of right to disconnect emerged in some of the advanced countries like France. Way back in about 2001 itself, there was this lady, Miriam El Khomri, who proposed this legislation in the form of right to disconnect. It was actually a legislation, if you look at the timing, which was issued in the time of world economy opening up to the digital age. So it was adapting labor law to the digital age, because in digital economy or digital work, what happens is you are working around the clock, because once your time zone's 8 hour finishes, somebody else's time zone's 8 hour begins. So it was causing a lot of health problems, particularly for women who were trying to juggle their labor at home and in the industry. So this El Khomri legislation was greeted with a lot of support, and it became reinforced or copper-fastened by 2015. With the passing of the labor code in France. Simultaneously, we had similar development in Germany, in Canada. Today, the trend is to have such legislation which insists on right to disconnect. That means you can't ping the employee or you can't intervene with their personal life. There should be a very clear line demarcating your workspace and your domestic space. However, with the digital economy, this space is blurring, and we had a real lethal effect during COVID-19. So this kind of impact can be creating a lot of stress, mental health issues, and also the toxicity in terms of expanding the stress of the workplace to the house, giving no mental space for other relationships and other side of the life like recreation, etc. So this legislation was taken as a kind of front runner by our own MP, Ms. Supriya Sule, in 2018 in India. It never saw the light of the day due to the subsequent COVID-19 related exigencies. But we see that this legislation is going to make a huge difference, with India being at the receiving end of digitization globally, and large number of Indian workforce is engaged there, and large number of women are engaged there. So it's a very important approach. But the positive side is that even European Union is looking at expanding this idea to the whole of Europe. In India, we have been one of the progressive nations, at least, to debate it in the parliament and looking at it. But the negative side of the legislation is that even today in France, this right of withdrawing from work whether it is acceptable in case of exigency like healthcare, especially with the COVID-19, with small manpower when the sector was struggling. Suppose you work because of that exigency, will that employee be punishable? How do you negotiate your rights? And if you refuse to work, will that be considered as misconduct? Even now, an organization is compelled to have such agreements, is considered to be penalized, or it can attract penalty if it refuses to do such agreements. And what is that agreeableness? What are the criteria is still uncertain. So if unless we address those gaps, the synchronization between different segments could be very difficult. For example, in a company management team, vis-a-vis that company being healthcare company having a hospital, how do you sync the two in terms of this right to disconnect is going to be a major issue and they need to be resolved.
Very true, madam. Very rightly expressed. And this brings me to another question. Over the years, what's happened is when we think of Indian industry, we think of manufacturing units. But if we see, the IT industry has grown exponentially. And what has happened over the years, rather, we took pride. The Prime Minister also made a mention of some figures. The Honorable Prime Minister said that we have reached the highest IT exports this year. And it's a matter of pride for all Indians. But the question is, in the IT industry today, the demand and supply rules, somebody leaves the IT industry, he gets another job very easily. But when the Indian IT industries are growing, there's a mushrooming of all Indian industries, there's going to be a time in near future when people cannot afford to lose jobs because they might not get another one. And in this sort of a situation, the tug of war would be to maintain their position or to hold on to their position in the present company. This will lead to consolidation of workers and there would be an emergence of IT unions. Now, my question to you is, how do you think employee unions in the IT industry in the near future? Yes, madam.
Recently in the post-COVID-19 scenario and during COVID-19 also, we saw that digital work assumed center stage and digital approach became the lifeline of our human interaction. So there is a huge demand which has come in the post-COVID-19 scenario because of the economy trying to gear up and businesses trying to make up the loss of last or non-working of last 2 years or impeded space. There is a lot of demand for the IT sector workers. However, as International Labour Organization also pointed out, and recent legislation in California also pointed out, IT sector is the sector which has large scale retrenchment, very flexible labor contracts, sometimes no employment contracts, and sometimes it has got a different kind of orientation altogether because of its transborder nature, global nature as well. Now, this has resulted in some of the evils which the labor law has tried to prevent and also resolve, such as massive retrenchments, job insecurity, work condition regulation, work hour regulation, or discrimination as well. So we saw in 2014, the first ever trade union emerge in case of IT sector in Bangalore. In Pune, recently, FIT has been registered and they are looking at a confederation of all trade unions at the all India level by IT sector. Now, I see this development happening mostly because there is an increased membership of women being taken up here. And IT industry or IT sector being very, very indifferent. I'm not saying it's against, indifferent to labor law, because they never felt there was a regulation or compliance that is required as there is a voluntariness on the part of the employees. And they also wanted it very flexible, very open, etc. Now, taking unfair advantage, in my opinion, the employers have gone on. Recently, in Google, when the trade union movement started, out of their 400,000 employees, only a few became the members. Now, this is, I think, only 400 became members of trade unions out of some 2 crore employees. So this shows that despite the trade union being there, there is something that is preventing these people from becoming members. So when we analyze, what we see is this is an expert workforce, and most of them are at the top tier, highly paid kind of levels. So they have a tendency to think that they may incur the wrath of the employer, they may be blacklisted, so they did not want to risk. On the other side, we have seen the FIT in Pune having referred 70 cases to the labor commissioner and about 17 cases being successfully brought to the courts. So this shows that there is a growing trend of injustice and unfairness and non-compliance to the labor law of the land, just like how we saw in big data companies, compliance to the law of the land being forced now by Facebook and to Facebook and Google and others. The same trend will be percolating down to the real life of human entities like employees in the form of this collective bargaining platform create this kind of an opportunity for justice. But the prerequisite is create awareness. Therefore, FIT is embarking more on awareness. Unless there is awareness of their rights as employees, where will be the collective bargaining and negotiation starting from? So that is the first step. And then all these other successful metrics will be synchronized into that to make this kind of IT sector to be just and fair. That is the sentence I use, to be just and fair, like any other avenue of employment, which has a direct nexus to right to life, right to livelihood, and right to quality of life.
Thank you, madam. And this brings me, on behalf of the viewers, to our next question. Well, somewhere it said that you have to return to the basics and understand what are the basics of unemployment theories, because tomorrow, with the burgeoning population in India, we are already 136 crores today. And then everybody cannot be given a job. And then people look at governments as it's the government's duty to give them jobs, private industry, this, that. But there is going to be an element of unemployment. So what, according to you, are the theories of unemployment? Yes. I mean, from the academic point of view. Yes, madam.
This is a very good question, and it is a very pertinent question as far as India is concerned. If we look at unemployment as such, I would see it as a kind of very lethal and devastating phenomenon as far as our youth is concerned. However, if you go to the theories from economics and other allied theories, you would see that unemployment is not a wholly negative phenomenon. It has got certain, it acts as a bulwark against developments within the industry. So unemployment outside is not something that industry can be insulated from inside. So one dimension I would like to say is that how do we look at unemployment? Unemployment is an economic challenge. It's a social challenge, because wherever there is unemployment, we do not see high grade education. We don't have social goods being catered to properly, like hospitals, etc. We do not have, it's a very location specific kind of impact if you are looking at inflation. Unemployment also has got one positive impact, namely it puts a pressure on the resources in terms of people consumption, because if everybody is employed, people will consume more and there will be pressure on the environment. So there is an ecological bulwark against, argument which goes for unemployment. The third dimension is physical and mental health dimension. Somebody who is unemployed suffers from low self-esteem. There's a social rejection. There is no self-respect. So this could result in extreme step of suicide or social alienation, which is very important for our youth. Now, on the other side, unemployment acts like a cushion for the industry, because those who are employed in the industry, They are able to assert their rights advantage and their position as employees based on two theories which are coming up. One is that allocative efficiency. Those who are employed, are they in the right job with their right kind of skills? So that gives us insights on how to retain the people and how to upgrade their skills, etc. The other one is full employment, the other theory. That is about whether the person who is employed is paid the full payment, which is prevalent in the market. We do not see full employment in private sector. We do not see the full employment being a negative trend also, because if someone is paid less than the market, then that person will not shirk the responsibility. That person will always try to arrive at that full employment, so is in the constant expectation state. And if you go by the Shapiro-Strictlitz model, unemployment and shirking and efficiency relationship, if you see, in a way, it is unemployment which, in terms of providing this impetus to shirking, which causes this balance to be there. However, with increasing international trade and increasing impact of stress on the mental health of the people, and sometimes physical health as well, in terms of poor nutrition and choices that they make, the creating more employment opportunities need to be paid attention, especially in a country like India, where there is a huge young demography of 65%, to align our education, our skills training, and also discovering new and correct alignment of education and skills and opportunities and proper planning at the top level. So this is how I would see the whole theoretical movement going towards that. Another point is, if you look at in the post-World War scenario, America had a 49 hours a week kind of approach, and it came down to 40 hours with the mechanization of agriculture and other things, and mass production of cars and Fordization. Now in India today, we are at the threshold of artificial intelligence, digital economy coming up, and the whole Amazonization and Flipkartization. So there are going to be new employment avenues which need to be properly presented before the young population and need to be seen differently in terms of policy and law.
Yes, madam, thank you so much. And we are so blessed and so happy with all the answers, and you have enlightened us a lot. But one more thing, I mean, there is an expectation of all our viewers from you, and my question is very simple. What is your message to budding HR managers, budding IR managers, and law students? So, and youngsters in general, youngsters in the sense, I will call everybody a youngster till the age of 40. So they are all, they have just entered the Indian industry. And what is your message to them? Yes, madam.
As a teacher and as an educationist, as well as a lawyer by training, what I would suggest is be fair. Don't give scope for unfairness in any manner, because this is one value and one innate calling which is missing, as I see. The minute you are fair, everything falls in place. And to be fair, be educated about what is fairness and keep learning. So learning and commitment to fairness, commitment to justice are going to make a difference in terms of prosperity always. Where there is wisdom or Saraswati, there the Lakshmi is going to be there. She can't run away. So please see that your prosperity sits with, or your power sits with, that compassion to do justice.
Yes, madam. On behalf of the viewers, I asked you a volley of questions. Questions were very diverse. COVID to academics, academics to expectation of industry, expectations of industry to emergent emergence of IT unions. So many of the questions, but let me tell you very frankly, you have answered and enlightened us with the vistas of this subject to the beyond our imagination. I mean, there are no words, madam, but all our viewers would be much happy and quite satisfied, as they have understood right to disconnect and everything in a proper parlance. Okay. It's time for me to bid a goodbye to you. Not this way. Maybe in near future, in future, someday we are going to invite you again. Okay. And thanks, madam. Thanks for coming and enlightening the audience by your views. Thank you so much. Yes.
Thank you very much, Dr. Srikanth. It has been a very interesting interview than the other interviews which I have faced, because here I'm catering to a group of people who come from that walk of life, which works with many disciplines like management, communication, law. In addition to that, it is an avenue which I left long ago before joining Symbiosis Law School in 2007, where I learned the verticals of recruitment, performance management, workforce management, and training and development. So it was a great opportunity to recall that. Thank you very much.
So friends, in our journey of imparting knowledge. Today we had Dr. Shashikala Gurpur in this wonderful interview on academics and industry. In our continuing journey of expert talks, tomorrow in the next segment we are going to have some other expert, but then it's time for me to say a goodbye to you. Okay, thank you friends, thank you for watching the interview, thank you.